Want to say greetings once again to the peculiar people of Yahweh. It's time once again for our weekly prophetic soundbite. As many of you know, I'm Pastor Emeritus Reverend Ron L. Spratley. I'm going to ask for your undivided attention this morning as I share with you a message, a soundbite that the Holy Spirit has led me to talk about this morning. And we're going to be spending some time talking about tribulation period indicators. What are some of the things we should be looking at as the Bible fulfills itself as it relates to the tribulation period? I've had questions from people wanting to know, are we in the tribulation? And I'm going to probably be a little bit longer than I normally am because I'm going to allow the Spirit to lead me. And when he's leading me, I got to let him take charge and tell me what he wants to share with you this morning. These tribulation period indicators that I'm going to be talking about comes from Matthew 24, where Christ was talking with his disciples and followers. And we're going to be coming from Revelation chapter 6. I've preached on these things before. So we got five indicators we're going to try to cover this morning. The first one I want to talk about, and let me just share with you, I believe, based on my studies of the Bible, that we're at the beginning of the tribulation period, only the beginning of the tribulation period, based on the indicators that we're going to talk about today. The first one deals with people. And we've been preaching in a series talking about inappropriate behavior of people. And people are the big driver of this whole tribulation period concept and indicators. Why is that? Why are people the driver? Because you've got to understand God, Yahweh, is a judge. He's given us a way out. He's given us a plan. He's given us his son, all right? And part of his plan requires us to live holy. Holiness keeps you in covenant with God. Again, holiness keeps you in covenant, the blood covenant. It keeps you in the blood covenant with God. And unholiness takes you out. And God, being a judge, okay, he hates sin. And man has a sin nature, but he was gracious in sacrificing his son to give us an option out of our sin nature. But we have to choose to take that option through faith. Now, this unholiness, we've been talking in our series about inappropriate behavior of people. And when you're unholy, you transgress or you violate the word of God, you disobey the word of God. This is what we've been calling sin, and we've been calling sin inappropriate behavior. Well, in Matthew 24, Christ said in these end times, in this tribulation period, he talked about there was going to be lawlessness. And again, lawlessness is just blatant transgression of the scripture and the laws of God. And if you look around at all, you can see all the inappropriate behavior that people have now, all of the lawlessness, all of the crime, all of the violence, all of the stealing, all of the smash and grabs. We're seeing all of it now. This is lawlessness. And the beauty of the scripture, Christ predicted this lawlessness was going to occur in the end times over 2,000 years ago. And we're in the midst of seeing this lawlessness now. Okay? We are experiencing a lack of love. I want you to see how all this is integrated together. There's a lack of love. Christ in Matthew 24 spoke to us and said that love would wax cold. Love would grow cold. So we're seeing this lack of love right now. And the third driver in this unholiness, we're seeing division. United, we can stand. Divided, we fall. We see division in the family. We see division in the church. We see division in politics and government. Everywhere we look, we are experiencing division. So the main driver, one of the main drivers in this tribulation period, and the reason I say we are in the early stages in the beginning of it, the people have peeled off, and such a high percentage of the society have chosen to live unholy. Okay, they've chosen to live unholy. All of us have a sin nature, and all of us sin, but this unholiness is uncovered sin that has not been covered by the blood of Christ. Remember our two-step process. Number one, accept Christ as your Lord and Savior. And number two, we talked about coming under the governing authority of the Holy Spirit. This is our two-step process, okay? And it is through the divine power of the Holy Spirit, we get our power from Christ through the Holy Spirit. It is through this divine power that we're able to bring our sin nature under control. It is through this divine power. This is why it's so important that we yield and submit, okay, to the governing authority of the Holy Spirit, that we don't, what, resist the Spirit, that we don't, what, grieve the Spirit, that we don't, what, quench the Spirit. Now, all these are integrated. And in these end times and in this tribulation period, we've talked about the horse, the white horse of deception. This white horse of deception, I want you to think about this digital age that we're in and how much information moves across the technology of the internet in the run of minutes. Trillions of bytes of information are moving across the internet. Some truth is coming across the internet. Some deception is coming across the internet. That's why you have to be grounded in Bible doctrine so you can discern the difference between truth and error. And when a large percentage of the population is not grounded in Bible doctrine, you can be easily deceived by this white horse of deception. And that's another one of our indicators that I look at, how much truth and how much error is getting into the people, being internalized by the people. As a preacher, I'm a drum major for truth, that you can be able to discern truth from deception. So that's one of our indicators. Second horse, war and bloodshed. We're seeing that. Just look around globally. We've got the situation in Ukraine, very sad situation. War, bloodshed. That's the second horse. All of this is integrated together. All of these things are happening at one time. But I want you to understand the behavior of people is at the center of all of this, my friends. All right? We're going to spend some time today. Once I get through this first slide, I need you to stay with me because we're putting this out here to help you. We're going to talk about inflation and famine. All right, we're going to spend some time talking about that today. The Black Horse. I'm going to use some of my experience and training in this area to share some things with you. And then we've got this pale horse that I'm calling infectious disease. So let me talk about this pale horse out of Revelation 6. And I took this pale horse and I integrated it with some things Christ said in Matthew 24. So with this pale horse, one of the things he was called in Revelation chapter 6, he was referred to as what? He was referred to as death and hell was riding this horse. Death and hell was riding this pale horse. But when we look at Matthew chapter 24, Christ also referred to pestilence. So I integrated this horse, which was referred to as death and hell and the grave, with what Christ was talking about with pestilence. And that's where I'm showing this pale horse as infectious disease. Now, we call in these indicators. So when you look at the current indicators, one of the things we see with infectious disease is we see all of these versions of coronavirus. And on this horse, we talked about death and hell was on this horse. So globally, we've seen about 6.5 million deaths just associated with the coronavirus alone, 6.5 globally, and we've surpassed 1 million deaths in the US associated with infectious disease. So you can see all of these five indicators that I'm sharing with you this morning, all right? They're all active. You can always observe them if you pay attention. If you don't allow the noise and the lies to distract you from what's really going on. Now, before I move to my next slide, I just want to share with you, in this time that we're in, it's very important that you are under skillful leaders who are being led by the Holy Spirit. Because your skill development in this period of time is going to be very, very important, my friends. So you need to be rolling with people who are skilled, who know what they're doing, and people who are following the Lord. So let's go to our next slide. Stay with me. This is our next slide here. I'm gonna see if I can move myself over here. Ask you to bear with us this morning. We're coming to you live, so stay with us. This slide, I wanted to share with you. The Spirit led me to share this slide with you. What I wanna talk about, the Black Horse, we talked about. Okay, we talked about inflation. We talked about famine. That's how we describe this black horse. So famine means a severe lack of food. And I want to share with you, I'm going into, you know, I'm a graduate of Alabama A&M and I spent time as a faculty member at Alabama A&M. And I'm going to go into what my students used to say, and I heard them in the hallway talking about they're going to Spragonomics. Spragonomics was the economics class, the forest economics class that I used to teach as part of the faculty. So we're going to do a little Spragonomics today, if you will. All right. Now, in this chart, we go back all the way to 1866. And this is about U.S. corn yield. We go from 1866 to 2021, and we're looking at bushels per acre. Yield is important in agriculture, all right? What is my yield? How much am I producing? So when we go back to the beginning of this chart, you can see from the beginning here, from 1866 coming all the way up to about 1936, look at our yield. We were somewhere between 20 and 30 bushels per acre. That was it, 20 to 30 bushels per acre. I want you to grasp that, because I'm going to be talking about some actions I need you to take because of the things we're talking about. I'm not giving you an opinion. I'm sharing data with you. Data, information, and knowledge. So you can make a decision on what you want to do. Now, for people who don't want to listen, you don't have to listen. God has given you a free will. Pastor Williams and I are out here for the people who want to listen, people who want counsel, people who want to try to take action to protect themselves and their families. So you see these yields. This is nothing I'm making up. This is from the USDA. That was the best we can do at that time. Now, after World War II, we had the birth of the chemical industry, as the slide says. And the big thing that happened here that changed our yields was, okay, fertilizer. Big breakthrough in fertilizer. I'm not trying to make agricultural majors out of you, but I'm trying to give you the truth of what's going on. And being a graduate of the School of Agriculture, I understand the concept of how powerful fertilizer is on the yield of all crops. For food, for trees, fertilizer plays a major role. Okay? In agriculture, as a student, I learned about three things. NPK. NPK, nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. Okay, doing my undergraduate work, getting my bachelor's, right, we had to take classes in soil science. All right, I had to have a year of soil science. And in soil science, we studied the nutrients in the soil, nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, changes the yield of an acre of agricultural land, changes the yield in forestry of an acre of trees. Now, what has been going on, all right? When they discovered, particularly when they discovered how to fix nitrogen, NPK took off, and our yields went from 20 to 30 bushels per acre. Look at where we are now. We can get 180 bushels of corn when we fertilize. But look where we were when we were not fertilizing. All right, we went from 20 to 30 up to around 180. Now, the cost of fertilizer has gone up from about $200 to $300 per ton. Please listen, people. From $200 to $300 per ton, fertilizer now is costing the farmer anywhere from $1,000 to $1,300 per ton. And it's in short supply. price increases represents shortage of supply. When demand for something exceeds the supply, the price has to go up. Welcome to Spragonomics. When the demand for something exceeds the supply, price goes up. So price is a reflection of the availability of that particular commodity. Now, because fertilizer, the price has increased so much, a lot of the farmers are saying, I cannot afford to use the fertilizer that I once used because it's no longer $300 per ton. It's over $1,000 per ton now. So if the farmer decides he can't use what he used to use, my point is the productivity per acre, the bushels per acre, are at risk of dropping significantly. Now, here's the main point I want to make as we leave this particular slide. When we were producing 20 to 30 bushels of corn per acre, all right, we only had about 2 billion people on the planet. This is the black horse we're talking about, inflation and famine. Down here, we only had about 2 billion people on the planet. Up here, we've got 8 billion people to feed. Again, I'm emphasizing something. I might be long today, but I'm trying to make a point across to those who are willing to listen. 2 billion people to feed, 8 billion people to feed. Without fertilizer, without the NPK, we cannot feed 8 billion people. Without the farmer using NPK, this yield will drop significantly. We're going to be following these yields on this channel because we study both natural law and we study spiritual law. When these yields drop, I'm going to try to share with you how we get from where we are right now to this famine and inflation that the Bible talks about. If the farmer doesn't use the fertilizer and the fertilizer prices stay over $1,000 per ton, this yield is going to drop significantly. We're feeding 8 billion up here. Agricultural studies on this particular crop, when we're just using corn as an example, fertilizer affects all crops. And if this drops, let's just say 50%, and this comes back down to 80 bushels per acre, our yield drop because we can't use the fertilizer, we probably have well over 2 billion plus people that we're not going to be able to feed. 2 billion. That would be serious famine. I'm just looking at the data. I'm just interpreting the data, following the Bible and interpreting what's happening in the world. And if this happens to all of the crops, and we're going to look at some price indicators on a number of crops, including corn, I can easily see how we get to inflation and famine from here. So I want you right now, I want you to prepare yourself. I'm pointing out some issues, but I'm also want to give the followers of this channel some solutions. So here, one of the things I want to recommend that you can do. First of all, if this comes to pass, and this has been predicted by the Bible, so I believe it's going to come to pass. The only issue uncertainty I have is on the timing of it. I can't tell you the exact time, but I can see all the variables that's going to cause this to come to pass based on simply interpreting the data. I follow this data all the time. I'm sharing it with you now because I'm sounding the alarm. We have some serious problems, and the chickens are coming home to roost because we've made some serious leadership errors on how we've managed the earth. You remember I did the sermon on stewardship. Okay, we are managers for God, and we've mismanaged a lot of things on this planet. So this is, the probability is real high. We're going to have some issues here. So the first thing I need you to do, I need you to carry extra inventory. Number one, carry extra inventory of non-perishable goods. Matter of fact, I would suggest you carry extra inventory on everything because we've got supply chain issues. This is an action step you can take. You remember the story in the Old Testament when famine came, how Joseph stored up grains so the people of Egypt could be prepared. Well, we are God's people, and he wants us prepared. So number one, carry extra inventory. Number two, you should visit your supermarket more frequently for two reasons. You need to be in there to look at the inventory situation, and you probably are going to need to make more frequent purchases to get through this. And thirdly, for those of you out there who are gardeners, who have a green thumb, by all means, go ahead. So that's my recommendations from this particular slide. You see the situation. We're only showing you the facts. I'm going to switch over now to another slide that we're going to take a look at. So now we're going to another slide and we're going to take a look. Stay with me. Spragonomics 101. We're going to take a look at pricing. Remember the Black Horse talked about what? Inflation and famine. So on this slide, we're going to look at the price of corn. Yeah, the price of corn. Ethanol comes from corn, all right? We've got fructose that goes into drinks and fruit punch. A sweetener comes from corn. So you will be surprised and you will be amazed about the number of things that come from corn. Yeah, tacos come from corn. So you got a lot of corn-based products, starches, what come from corn. So let's look at the price of corn and let's look at what it's been doing because we're looking at inflation. Well, we could see back here, 2010, look, you got, this is the price. So you got a really good, really good price here, $3. That's what that is, $3.05 per bushel. All right, you could see what it went up to back in this 2012. It went up to $8.49 per bushel. So we had a big rise. And it's the speed of the rise that you should be concerned with. But you can see it went back down to $3.14, $3.09. But look, since the pandemic, you can see the low during the pandemic, $3.09. But look what has happened and look at the speed at which this is accelerating. Went to $7.35, pulled back, $4.97, $8.24 now. Now, anybody who has studied statistics, and I'm not trying to make experts out of you, I'm just trying to share with you things that hopefully will get you to take action. All right? That's all I'm trying to do. Now, this is what we call Bollinger Bands. This is a statistical concept, all right? And the main thing I want you to take away from this represents two standard deviations. And this might be over some folks' head, but here's the main thing. 95% of the price of corn should stay within, 95% of the time, this price should stay within these orange lines. This is what we call, I used to teach statistics too, okay? This is what we call upper control limit. This is what we call a lower control limit on these bands here. And anytime the price of something gets outside of these bands, remember we said 95% of the time, it should stay between the bands, but it's outside, right? Comes back in here just at the top and it goes back up. I want you to see, this is what we call a special event. When these prices stay outside of the band for an extended period of time, something's going on. This price indicator is letting you know something special is happening. All right? You can see when it's gone out in the past, it went out briefly here, came back in, went out briefly here, came back in. What I want you to understand, look how long it stayed outside on this particular instance. You see my point. Something special is going on. I want you to have an action plan. Now, we've looked at corn. Now we're going to look at some other commodities here. We've looked at corn. Let's look at a few other things here. Stay with me. Let's look at soybeans. Now, I'm not going to go through everything like I did last time, but you got the concept. Look at soybeans. Outside, two standard deviations. Something special going on. So we got corn, we got something special going on. We got soybeans, we've got something special going on. The price is outside of two standard deviations. Okay, this is not to scare you, this is to prepare you. The black horse famine, inflation and famine is running, okay? That is the soybean complex. Let's look at wheat. You know what's happening with the war in Ukraine. We know 20 to 30% of the grains come out of Russia and Ukraine, and they're at war right now. God wants his people prepared. I want the followers of this station to be prepared. Look at the wheat complex. You know the things that wheat, pizza, the breading on pizza, rolls, all right? Bagels, all of this stuff, loaf of bread. You looked at the price of a loaf of bread in the grocery store lately? Well, look at the acceleration in wheat. We were down here around $400 a bushel. Look at where we are now, $1,278. $12 a bushel back here was $13 a bushel. Notice, again, we're outside of our upper band here, and we've been outside of it for 3-4 months now. I want you to see the trends. Let's continue. Now, we got supply on one side. We've been talking about corn. We've been talking about soybeans. We've been talking about wheat. That's in short supply. And on the flip side, what I want you to see, I want you to see what's happening with the money supply. All right? You know, when you got all this stimulus and all of this stuff that you said, you know, was free money. Well, let's look at what happened to the money that's in circulation. Look at the trend going back to 2003.
3 and look at this jump. That's all of the free money, the stimulus money. Nothing is really free. All right. So that's contributing to this inflation factor. We've got all of this money floating and slushing around. On top of that, we got people who don't want to work. So when people don't work, you're not producing anything. The farmers having a difficult time finding people to come labor on the farm. You know, people don't want to get dirty. All my buddies who went through the School of Agriculture with me at Alabama A&M, man, we would be dirty. We come in from the forest and agricultural land, and the people would laugh at us. We go to the cafeteria, man, they laugh. What y'all doing in school getting this dirty? So everybody wants to be what we used to call a pretty boy. Nobody wants to put the coveralls on and go work anymore. I'm too old to continue to do it. A lot of my buddies are too old. So who's going to feed the people? That's what we got to be thinking about. I know I was a little bit long, but the Spirit has put this on my mind to share this with you today. I hope this has blessed you. We pray that you're going to continue to support and listen to this ministry. Again, we want to encourage you, share these videos with the people you care about, with the people you love. We have to do our part to make this society a better place to live. So I think, in conclusion, I think we're at the beginning phase of the tribulation period. I still believe the same way the Lord made a way out for Noah before he judged the world in the Old Testament, for the current faithful disciples who follow Christ, I believe he's going to come back to get us. He's going to make a way out for us. But until he comes, we've got to be good stewards. And until he comes, we've got to continue to preach. We've got to continue to get this gospel out. We've got to continue to grow in grace and wisdom. And my friends, we're asking you, Pastor Williams and I, asking you, help us. Help us spread this gospel. Whenever you find value in these videos that Pastor and I put out here, give us that thumbs up. Just click. That is simple. Click on it. You like what we're doing, click on that thumbs up. If you like what we're doing, share these videos with somebody else so you can bless somebody else. We're trying to bring as many people to the gospel. We want to reach, Pastor and I want to reach as many people as we can reach in these end times, so they can have a safe passage out of this place as God begins the progressive judgment on the world. We thank you for your time. We thank you for your commitment. And we thank you for your support. Have a blessed day.